What happens to the things we build when they're no longer required? Well, that depends on the thing. If it's made from valuable materials, we might take it apart and recycle the materials. If it's a building, it might be knocked down and redeveloped. Sometimes, though, they simply become abandoned and forgotten. But they still make for fascinating stories. Let's look at some of those stories together. Even something as humble as an old meatpacking plant can become fascinating when it begins to decay. Especially if it's the old Armour meatpacking plant in East St. Louis, Illinois, USA. The washed-out bricks and rusty steel skeleton of the plant look like something out of a post-apocalyptic video game. And so it's no wonder that the site has become popular with urban explorers. This was once the second largest facility of its kind in America, employing 4,500 people and offering guided tours of the processing center to interested, if bloodthirsty, tourists. Armour eventually shut the plant down and moved to another location in 1959. They handed the building back to the city of East St. Louis, but the city authorities never did anything with it. It's been abandoned to rack and ruin ever since then. Without anyone to look after it, the building has slowly begun to collapse in on itself, with falling bricks smashing the broken shells of the old equipment. You can walk all the way up to the plant by following its old, dedicated railroad line, but enter at your own risk. The Scarista bus on the Isle of Harris in Scotland would look like any other abandoned old bus if it weren't for the simple fact that it's so obviously out of place. It looks like it was abandoned here many decades ago, but it's actually only stood in this spot since 2005, and it's technically open to visitors. The bus was intended as a replacement for a caravan used by the local Boy Scout group, which was destroyed by high winds in January that year. The bus was donated as a replacement for the caravan by a local coach company. Work immediately began on converting the bus into a habitable space, with a new kitchen area and communal seating along with a new bathroom. It's fair to say that none of those new additions look quite so new anymore. Despite the seemingly derelict state of the bus, it still contains a logbook for visitors to sign, along with songbooks and storage lockers with clean blankets inside. Nobody seems to know when or why the coach was abandoned, but it probably isn't somewhere that parents would relish the idea of sending their children anymore. The mining industry isn't what it used to be. You'll find abandoned mines all over the world, but perhaps none so picturesque as Minas dos Cadis in Serra do Guedes, Portugal. This mine, situated on the country's border with Spain, hasn't seen a day of labor since the 1970s. In truth, it wasn't a successful mine. It opened in the 1940s and mined tungsten, but returns began to dwindle just 10 years later, and by the 1970s, the mine was no longer financially viable. Since the workers left, Minas dos Cadis has become home to wild horses and goats. You'll still find the occasional tourist here, though, marveling at the view it offers over the surrounding countryside at the height of almost 5,000 feet above sea level. Most of the mine's offices and buildings are still standing and are open to explorers, but you're warned that the underground access shafts are open and are exactly as dangerous as you'd expect them to be. There's something magical about this place, especially when it's covered in snow during the winter, but it can be dangerous. There's a very strange sight to see in the remote Russian village of Linakamari. It's a difficult place to get to, more than 150 miles away from the nearest big city of Murmansk, and just 10 miles from the country's border with Norway. You'd have to be a determined traveler to get here, and you wouldn't find anyone waiting for you here once you completed the trip. Linakamari is abandoned, and has been since the middle of the 1990s. It's a former military settlement, but after the collapse of the Soviet Union, it no longer had a purpose. Look around, though, and you'll find several reminders of its military days. The most striking and bizarre of them is the Linakamari Memorial, which consists of the bow of a boat seemingly embedded in the solid rock of a cliff face. This strange memorial is a dedication to the Soviet sailors who lost their lives during the Second World War. While you won't find anyone here waiting for you, you will see a familiar face. It's the face of former Soviet leader Vladimir Lenin, painted onto the side of another cliff close to the embedded ship. Dunmore Park House in Dunmore, Scotland has become so badly overrun by nature that it's difficult to see it from ground level until you're right next to it. It's far easier to see from above, where it looks beautiful in drone photography. If you're capable of beating your way through the bushes and getting to it, you'll find the charming but sad skeleton of what was once one of the most opulent and extravagant mansions in Scotland. The property was built for wealthy private owners during the 1820s and included fields and a large stable for the family's horses. The stables are long gone, and the fields are so overgrown that they've merged with the rest of the plants and weeds that are slowly chewing their way through the brickwork. It's thought that some of the damage that's been done to Dunmore Park House is deliberate. Whoever owned it by 1972 didn't enjoy paying tax on what was by then a mostly derelict building, so they had the roof removed and declared it a write-off. The grounds of the building are home to the Dunmore Pineapple, a large stone building with an equally stone sculpture of a pineapple on top of it, made for unknown reasons. Presa El Gasco is a half-built testament to what happens when people have big ideas and a lot of money to spend on those ideas, but don't have the vision to see the project through to completion. When building work began on Presa El Gasco in Las Rosas de Madrid, Spain in the 18th century, it was supposed to become the tallest gravity dam in the world. The plan involved creating a waterway that would extend more than 400 miles from here to Lisbon. After completing the 173-foot-tall starting point, it became clear that the waterway would never be able to supply enough money to create a new shipping industry here. While its designers considered their next move, part of the newly built structure collapsed in mysterious circumstances, and the project was abandoned. It later transpired that the project was massively over budget just from creating the initial structure, and the money that would be required to see it through to completion simply didn't exist. Today, it's little more than an interesting distraction for hikers as they make their way through the area. If we asked you to think of a place where Americans could go to see the faces of their former presidents rendered in stone, you'd think of Mount Rushmore. Perhaps you should think of Williamsburg in Virginia instead. After all, there are far more presidents to look at in this location. These 20-foot-tall busts of America's first 42 presidents were once part of President's Park, but President's Park closed down in 2010. The busts were supposed to be destroyed when the land was sold, but local construction worker Howard Hankins couldn't bear to see that happen to them. Instead, he had all of the heads transported back to his private farm. In doing so, he protected some of the finest work of Houston-based artist and sculptor David Addix. The problem is that Hankins didn't know what to do with the heads after having them brought to his farm, so they're all still standing out in his fields. He occasionally allows tour operators to bring the general public in to see them, but not very often and never for long. To make matters worse, several of them have now started to crumble after a decade of exposure to the elements and no maintenance. The village of Gamsutl in Russia, perched at the top of Mount Gamsutlmir, is one of the oldest in the region of Dagestan. It's also one of the loneliest. The name Gamsutl translates into English as "at the foot of the Khan's fortress," which implies that a local Khan chose this specific location 4,600 feet above sea level to build his home, recognizing correctly that he'd be very safe from attack here. If that's true, though, there's no historical record of it happening. Archaeologists have investigated the site thoroughly but struggle to put an age on it. It could be as old as 5,000 years, but it could also be 3,000 years younger than that. even during its peak years, there were only 300 or so occupied homes here, and no sign of a palace for the Khan. Visiting it today, you might get a sense that it was abandoned centuries ago, but there were still a few hundred people here as recently as the 1950s. You can even still see the 20th century post office and hospital amid the empty buildings. The city's last resident, Abdulkhalil Abdulkhalilov, refused to leave here when everyone else moved out because he'd lived in the village for his entire life. He passed away in 2015 after many years of living here in isolation. Eka Kula in Eka, Serbia, looks like the kind of place that might be home to a vampire in a horror movie. Failing that, it could be the castle of an old aristocrat. In reality, it's not a castle at all. This ruined building, turret and all, is actually an old water tower. More attention would probably be paid to it were it not for the presence of a genuine ruined castle about 10 minutes walk away from here. Because the castle hogs so much attention from tourists and archaeologists, the history of the water tower has become something of a local mystery. There ought to be a written record of its construction, but there isn't. Nobody alive today remembers it being built, and it's generally thought that it's been around since the second half of the 19th century. It owes its unique appearance to the German Neo-Romanesque movement of that era, which saw the erection of several needlessly elaborate buildings that served humble purposes. The turret is thought to be a guard tower. Archaeologists aren't sure whether the guard's job would have been to protect the water tower or whether they were stationed there as an additional defense for the nearby castle. If you squint at Cape Romano Dome House in Marco Island, Florida, from some distance away, it still looks like a dream vacation home. As soon as you get closer, though, it quickly becomes apparent that it's a wreck. It might not even remain standing for much longer. Several of the domes, which were once connected, are in danger of falling into the sea. There's some debate about how and why the property was built. Most sources agree that it's been here since 1981, but there are rumors that it was home to a religious cult or a group of UFO enthusiasts. The truth is likely to be a little more pedestrian. The most likely account is that the Dome House was built by former oil producer Bob Lee as an eco-friendly luxury vacation home for his family. His ideas included keeping the domes warm by lighting fires on the concrete pylons below the domes and using the dome-shaped roofs to direct rainwater into troughs so it could be collected for showering and washing dishes. We guess Bob had a weird definition of luxury. The domes were built to stand up to hurricane-force winds, but couldn't cope with the effects of erosion. The sand beneath the stilts that support the domes has shifted since 1981, and they'll eventually collapse. Lapalis Kalis in Lapalis, Poland still looks brand new. In some ways, it is. The castle isn't ancient, and it was never used. In fact, it was never even finished. Work on the castle began in 1979 when the Polish artist Piotr Kazimierczak decided he needed a new home and a new studio, and figured that they might as well be both under the same roof. Not content with that, Piotr also asked the construction company to include a ballroom, Gothic-style ramparts, a full-sized Olympic swimming pool, and 12 towers to represent the 12 apostles. There were two big problems with his plans. The first was that he didn't have enough money to pay for all the work. The second was that he didn't own the land that the castle extended onto. He pushed on for as long as he could, using local volunteers when he could no longer afford to pay professionals, and fighting multiple battles in court to gain permission to keep building on land he'd never bought, but was eventually forced to admit defeat in 1991. There have been many rumors about restoration and redevelopment plans for the castle since then, but nothing has ever come to fruition. Lapalis Castle is a castle that was designed by an artist. The buried village of Al Madam in the United Arab Emirates looks like a modern art installation. There's nothing deliberately artistic about Al Madam, though. This is simply what happens when a village becomes abandoned and the desert decides to reclaim it. The village is so tiny that it's probably more accurate to call it a hamlet. It contains just two streets of brightly colored houses with a mosque positioned at the end of the roads. Nobody knows why the village was abandoned. It was built during the 1970s and belonged to members of the local Al-Kutbi tribe, but was abandoned less than a decade after completion. Residents of the nearest town say that the tribe left because their new homes were haunted by terrifying demons called jinns, but it's more likely that the harsh realities of desert life drove them away. We can see what the sand has done to their former homes in the years since they left, and the area is also infested with scorpions. There are still visible mosaics, paintings, and even a few personal items in some of the homes, but they're rapidly filling up with sand. Subscribe to the channel, turn on the notification bell, and enjoy watching new videos on my channel. Thanks for watching, and see you soon!